Good evening, brother. I'm Janie Cohen. I'm director of the Fleming Museum, and we're really pleased to welcome you all to the museum tonight to hear Eric Aho speak about his work. And I first met Eric when I arrived at the Fleming many years ago. We showed his work in 1994, 19 years ago, incredibly enough. And if you've been on the balcony recently, you will see that we have two pieces, two paintings of his up there right now. One that we purchased in 94, Square Snowfield, and a recent piece entitled Vow from 2010 that are kind of looking at each other across the marble court. And they tell the story that you are going to hear from him tonight about the evolution of his work in recent years. Eric is a native of Melrose, Massachusetts, and a resident of Saxton's River, Vermont. He holds a BFA from Boston's Massachusetts College of Art and a diploma from the Central School of Art and Design in London. He has completed graduate and postgraduate studies in Cuba, Boston, and Finland. His work has been exhibited widely in both solo shows and group shows nationally, from really across the country, from Washington State to New York, as well as internationally, including exhibitions in Finland, Ireland, South Africa, Japan, and Cuba, among other places. His work can be found in the permanent collections of many major institutions, including the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, Ministry of Culture in Cuba, and the National College of Art in Oslo, and the Fleming Museum. Among a lot of collections, both public and private. He's represented by D.C. Moore Gallery in New York City, and in 2012, his work was featured at the Courier Museum of Art in a solo exhibition entitled Transcending Nature, Paintings by Eric Aho. In writing about Eric's work, art critic Donald Cuspid recently noted, and I quote, "Aho is an artist of sublime fullness," end quote. And you will no doubt understand that to be true by the time you leave tonight. So please join me in welcoming Eric Aho.
Hi, everyone. Nice to be here. Terve. We have to speak a little Finnish. Hello to our Finnish friends in the back. So Janie was counting the years, 19 years ago, and it was Janie's invitation to show a group of paintings was my first ever museum presentation on a really significant scale. In fact, the invitation came just, I didn't know what to do. I didn't have enough work for the show. I don't think she knew this, but I spent the entire winter making the work, and it arrived just barely set up. And those were 60 by 70 inch paintings, some of the largest paintings that I had made at that time, and it's still a size that I work in today. So a lot of things that I learned under pressure to make that show, I still adhere to today, and I'll talk about a little bit of that. The other thing that was really important with Janie's invitation is that it was also my first opportunity to speak in front of a group of people aside from my students. And at the time I was teaching at the Putney School, not a forgiving audience, all right? So I was relieved to see such kind faces and great responses with the first Fleming audience, and it appears that's going to be much the case here, although there is a Putney student in the audience, so please be kind, right? And you know, with that talk, I remember that since I've given most of my talks in the same manner, I don't have a clue about what I'm going to talk about in general. Although with this talk, I was asked to come up with a title, and I've never given a title to a talk, and I am often even resistant to give paintings titles. You'll see this one here is just the longest title I've ever given a painting. I can talk about that in a second. But I do recall that I talked about the landscape on the drive from Saxons River to Burlington. And I was also reading Barbara Kruger's Animal Dreams at the time, if you recall that. And I was struck by her idea of the jet lag of consciousness. Those are two things I remember talking about kind of extemporaneously. And when the invitation came to present this talk, I said, oh goody, I can be really ambitious. I've got so much time to plan, right? But I was also reading something and I thought, well, you know, I must, you know, I have to come up with a title and all this. And I took an idea from a collection of essays that I had been reading by Wallace Stevens, the American poet. And it's from a lecture that he gave at Princeton University in 1941. It's called The Noble Rider. And in it, he presents the term the pressure of reality. And I think the pressure of reality for him in that lecture, he was talking about the United States being on the edge of entering World War II and sort of dynamic social pressures all around. But I immediately saw it first as like, how on earth do I get to my studio? That's like the pressure of reality with two kids and life filling in. But I understood from Stevens that the pressure of reality is the exertion of influences on the consciousness. And the consciousness that he's talking about particularly is society. But I diluted that a bit so I could think about it particularly as an individual and those influences being visual. So I'm going to try to accomplish a few things here tonight. One is weave in some of those ideas into this talk. I'm also going to try to get you from here to there and back again. So the installation on the on the upper floor of the marble court is a good and an illustrative bracket of sort of what's happened in 19 years. I've been here a few times since, and I always check in on my painting, make sure the paint's not falling off. It's holding up really, really nicely. But it's a lot of fun to see it in contrast to something that's just a couple of years old, and in fact, very fresh and very current with what I'm trying to do right now. Well, hold on a second. I have to go back here. You know, can we put the lights down, Chris? Thanks. So, there we go. So I always think of these talks as sort of I can't have you all into my studio, partly because it's a house of cards with paintings standing on end, and it would be a mess. But I do like to think of these talks as an invitation into not only my studio, but into, if it's at all possible, into my head. And one of the only things I carry around in my head are images of other paintings. So you'll see plenty of those throughout the talk, too, in comparison to paintings that I've made recently. And so I'll contrast those paintings with paintings that are of importance to me. So the question is, Stevens wonders how the world comes to appear as a collection of solid and static objects extended in space, right? Like, how is it that we see things in an organized way? So Stevens says it's because of the intellect fails. It fails to present a true view of it. It presents a false view of it, right? And that just resonates with me to such an extent because I've shifted away from paintings that assemble the world in some recognizable way, in a way that everyone from my mother to my children to even myself can recognize as the world we stand in front of vertically. And I spent 20 years on a hillside, albeit it was in New Hampshire, but isn't there a Maxfield Parish saying that says he lives in New Hampshire to have a better view of Vermont. So 20 years looking out over this landscape, and I have so many ambitions for painting. I want it to represent not just the day and the moment, but I want it to represent, you know, past, present, future, all of these things at once. And in painting, I believe, is really the only medium that can do that. But so after a while, though, the painting, the painting started to become habit, and it started to become, in fact, a little bit, the habit of that painting became a little bit burdensome. And I had to ask myself some serious questions, which are some of the questions that I asked my kids, and I asked the kids that I coach. I say, are you having fun? You know? And it sounds like a small question, but it's really the sort of foundation to this serious endeavor, right? I mean, what more serious thing is there than painting? I mean, when you say that to painters, they all understand. But so yes, it has to be fun, and it started to become a duty, and I realized that's what happens when you're looking at something. You have an obligation to it, right? The plein air painter, the painter in situ, is obligated to record what's in front of them, and I didn't like that pressure. You know, I also should say that I was taking my lessons from, well, I'm always taking my lessons from my influences from a wide scope of artists. But one of the first artists that I encountered upon moving to Vermont was Tom Thompson, the Canadian. And I immediately recognized, and I think when we look at something, and as if you're artists, you'll understand this, I think you look at something and you're inspired by it. Why, right? You're inspired by it because you're jealous of it. And something in you says, I can do that, or I can do better than that, or that relates to how oh my God, that's exactly how I see it. And you know, when that's the case, you better remember that painting, and you better own it, and you may, in fact, then at that point, you make it your own. You know, so these paintings, it's Tom Thompson's name's ascribed to it there, and it was painted just 2 years before he died, but I did that. But before I could do that, before I could find the spot on that hillside, right? I mean, and on that hillside, you're looking at a landscape that has tremendous historical importance, and it's, above all, it's beautiful. And I was terrified of the beautiful, right? So when I came to Vermont, when I came to the Putney School, I came in 1989, and for the first couple of years, first 3 or 4 years of painting, I went further and further and further away from anything that smacked of beauty. In fact, I was living at the time in a house that had a commanding view of Mount Monadnock. It's one of the most majestic views I've ever seen anywhere in the world, and I had to wake up to this every morning. And I said, I am not dealing with that. I'm not painting it. I'm not even going to look at the sunsets. I'm not even going to enjoy it. I mean, I was also, you know, wrangling with some post-adolescent angst, so I said, I'm going to go deeper. I'm going to go far away from everything, so I'm not going to encounter anybody. And I spent an entire summer working in this ravine. Now, this is Hemlock Ravine. It's down, down, down. It takes a half an hour to walk down into this ravine from the hilltop at the Putney School campus. And it's 20 degrees cooler down there in August. It's, you know, it's 58 degrees, maybe 60 degrees. And I set up camp for 3 months. And I made one painting a day. And they took about 8 hours. And then I would walk back up the hill and cross the road. And at halfway through this adventure, this old lady, because I'm carrying my paints, and I had no idea how to paint. First of all, I was a printmaker, so I had never studied painting. I had to figure that out on my own, and I took the job to teach painting by saying, sure, you know, how hard can it be? I would never have hired myself, but I'm glad they did, and I learned a lot, and I will say I learned a lot, and I continue to learn a lot from my students, because you know it's an exchange. You know, this is a conversation. I mean, painting is about putting yourself out there in the world and to be responded to. You know, like here, you know, tell me something about it and guide me. I know what I'm doing, but I want your eyes. I want to see your expressions. I want to see, am I hitting the mark? And usually, when I hit the mark, I go far away from it. So, and I find another target. But so she took some pity on me and saw that my paper bag, which had been I'd been using for like 3 weeks, was duct taped and was falling apart. She came out with an L.L. Bean bag, and she said, "Oh, well, this might be of some use to you. My children keep giving them to me, and I have no use for it." She said, "I've got a dozen of them." She gave me this L.L. Bean bag and a peanut butter jar to keep. She said, "Painters need to have jars to keep their oils in." To this day, I still use the same peanut butter jar and the same L.L. Bean bag. And so eventually, I made my way out of that ravine and back up the hill. And partly it was partly just practicality, that it was it became arduous to sort of get down and hike down into that wood carrying all this gear. But and then I learned to find painting spots that were somehow rather comfortable, if I could say. This is painted in February, this in the wonderful town of Guilford in the south, and the sun is hitting the side of a barn outbuilding behind me, right? So it's out there in the winter, it's 25 degrees, but I'm sitting in this sort of microclimate of about 50, 55 degrees, and it's very, very comfortable, and I can paint all day long. And this is one of the last paintings that I did entirely on site in plein air. And the top half of it has everything that's about that I had come to know about sort of depicting, representing, responding to is even a word that I prefer to use to what I'm seeing in this environment. But at some point, I became distracted by the paint. Right? I became distracted by that plow pile in front there, and I spent I remember feeling like, oh my gosh, this is something I hadn't ever really paid attention to before. And I thought, wow, I could spend my whole life painting these piles. And I took a year out of my life to paint these piles and then piles of other things, including piles of birch logs and piles of white trash bags and piles of just anything I could find that reflected the light, I always wanted to have winter come back. I may be one of the only people who doesn't want winter to ever go away. I think it's for me it's sort of an absolutely magical time when I seem to understand everything so much better, and then I took. This painting comes right on the heels of that Guilford Valentine, and I kind of handled it in much the same way, but I let myself, it's painted in the studio, and I wanted to see if I could make a painting that felt like it was really painted on site, that it had all of the aspects of the fresh air, essentially. And one of the habits that I've developed working on that hillside was the habit and discipline, really, of taking the studio outdoors, taking all of the material, the tools, the accoutrements of the studio, the big pots, the palettes, and the big brushes, the things that would typically be in like a deKooning studio, and moving them out to the landscape. And then once I had been once the palette was charged up with the color of that day, once the quantities of paint were mixed and made and applied, and I had information on the canvas, even cursory observations, because I became aware at some point of how many changes a blue goes through as it passes through from the horizon through through the clouds. Take a look sometime. You'll see that there are at least a dozen changes that happen through a group of clouds, and it's an amazing thing. And sometimes you can't accomplish everything outside. So I developed the habit of taking that information from the outside and bringing it back in. But this is the first painting that was kind of like an assignment to myself. You know, can I do this? Can I really make something like that happen? And I started with that top ridge, and I started with much the way that I still do, which is a color that's left over from the previous day's painting. And that way, I'm conscious of not just the individual paintings that I'm working on, but I'm conscious of the entire body of work, if you will, of the thread that runs through everything that I'm doing. And you know, whether it's a landscape that has a recognizable object, or like the first one that I showed, that momentary brightness, there's something similar, there's something the same about them all. It's about my attitude, my intention remains the same. Something about the immediacy and the accuracy and the of response to the sensation. So now it's not just the sensation of what I'm looking at, but it's the sensation of what I'm remembering having seen and felt and heard and smelled simultaneously. So a mix of all the senses. And in this particular painting, it's also a mix of memory and a mix of someone else's story. So this is the imagined day that my grandparents chose to leave their beloved village in central Finland in 1903. And family lore has it that my grandmother never smiled again when she got to America. They were both from really large families, and she, until her death, continued to correspond with her six sisters. And funny, my grandfather never mentioned to anyone that he had said that he was the youngest of seven, rather the oldest of seven brothers. So when I discovered that, that was kind of unusual. But he didn't speak much. You should read Garrison Keillor on the Finns, right? So I'm trying to pack all of this information into a single painting. And for the first time, I realize what those plein air paintings weren't doing, is that as soon as I let go of the sort of the pressure of reality, right, the tyranny of the observed, the duty that I feel sort of beholden to. And certainly when you start painting something and you develop an accidental career and you start selling paintings, well, people want X, Y, and Z things. And I'm really a terrible businessman, and I could make a happy career painting white barns or something, but I just go the other way. It's like it's kind of the signal of like enough is enough, and I like doing this stuff so much, but I don't want to, I don't want to go down the wrong path. I want to stick to essentially, my own path, and just follow it sort of meanderingly. And then it occurred to me while I was making this that I was also dealing with contrasts that I'm always investigating in the paintings. And in this case, it was a contrast between this sort of incredibly clearly painted, beautiful sky. I wanted to paint a sky as beautifully as I had ever made, that I ever possibly could, a real challenge, I wanted to accomplish that in this painting. And then somehow, everything else in the painting fell into place, and it had to be rugged and scumbled and agitated and angry and in fact rather distasteful in a way, like not applied with any kind of care. So when I was realizing something that I was pulling together lessons from a painter like John Constable, the English painter, who as an adult left London and went back to his childhood home, and he began painting it. And he painted with a tremendous casualness, a carelessness, right? But he knew, he knew the place so well, he didn't have to, he wasn't beholden to it somehow. And I remember when I was a student in London, the Tate and the National Gallery of England had acquired and were exhibiting a treasure trove of both Turners and Constables. And all of my classmates were, you know, like abuzz about this. And I saw the Turners and I thought, wow, those are exciting. They were wild, right, to 20-year-old eyes. And the Constables, so I looked at them and I listened to my classmates, some of whom were just a few years older than I was, and I thought, I just don't get it. I'm not going to say that, but I just don't get it. And I went back again and I looked at them some years later and I still don't get it, didn't get it. And I looked again and again. Then all of a sudden, it started to come together. I was looking at it as a picture. I mean, in the English would say, you know, the subjects are twee. You know, they're little cottages and windmills. And I was looking at the wrong thing. I was misinformed about what the reality of this painting is. The reality of the painting is not the subject depicted. It's the reality that comes into its own being, right? In our imagination, certainly transferred through Constables. And the other thing about this painting that just stopped me in my tracks, this and many others, this is sort of a thread that runs through his work, is how spring-loaded it is, right? I hope that you've all had a chance to see a Constable painting up close, but the marks, I mean, they're like Pollocks. They're like Jackson Pollocks. The paint is flung and dripped and smeared and pushed in with his thumb, and then more is dragged on top. And then there's such a structure and a composition, but somehow the marriage between how it's built and how it's drawn, how it's painted, and how it's conceived is this sort of magical openness, right? This, you know, this horse is, every time you look at it and then look away and look back again, it's leaping again. There's something, you know, the cliche is, you know, the captured moment, but it's not, but you know, cliches never apply. There's something that's more, you know, arrested to it. You know, there's something that's, you know, an active thing made permanent, you know, a momentary thing made permanent, which is that link to the past, present, and the future. This is always moving. This is always happening. And it's, you know, it reminds me that paintings have a life of their own. And here's here's Frank Auerbach, who's been a disciple of Constable and also of Rembrandt. And the longer conversation is, to understand Constable, you have to understand all of the Rembrandts in the Royal Collection, because you don't have Constable without Rembrandt, and then you don't have Frank Auerbach. And Frank Auerbach is a painter that I immediately responded to when I was a printmaker in London. I mean, I could see it. I responded, much like I did to that Tom Thompson painting, to the muscularity, to the physicalness of the world of that paint. I didn't know how to do it, and it wasn't even on my mind that I would be doing that. It would still be another 5 years or so before I really started painting. So this sort of shopping list of painters, this is what I was saying. These are the pieces that I carry around in my head, and for the longest time, none more so than this little Rembrandt landscape, which is at the National Gallery in Dublin, Ireland. And it's one of the few landscapes that Rembrandt painted. It's 13 by 18. It's a tiny little panel. And I've always marveled at and wondered, you know, why do we respond to things the way we do? You know, I've looked at, you know, great paintings, masterpiece, you know, world masterpieces, and I've been unmoved. But then you see, incidentally, a little painting. Now, it's by Rembrandt, so you have to understand the quality of his connection to nearly everything he made was, frankly, perfect. And that's why he was Rembrandt then, and he's Rembrandt now, and he'll continue to be, because it's a human achievement beyond what might happen once every 500 years or so. Maybe Cézanne was the next Picasso maybe, but Cezanne certainly, you know, who had sort of a perfect eye somehow. But this little painting just entered my head immediately, and I think it was primarily because of the things that I was interested in myself, the contrasts, the distinction between spaces, and the distinction between a human element, in this case, the biblical story, and sort of a wild wilderness element. And but it's fundamentally about these two lights, right? There's this cold silver light breaking over that ominous ridge, and there's some weird castle there in the center. And then there's this, the settled sort of it's a transient, right? But it's the domestic light there of the fire. So there's these two amazing contrasts. And I came back to this after seeing that the first couple of times. I came back to my studio and I tried to make copies of it, right? Dutiful little copies. Like, I wanted to get into that painting so badly, and they were god awful, right? Scrape them off. If I have one left, it's way back in the closet somewhere. And then, you know, one day in March, I am, dealing with the pressure of reality, and I'm running to the bank and the post office before they close, and I drive past one of our local farmers, Steve Moore, has fields on the road that leads into Bell's Falls, and he was clearing the brush and burning it, and the sky was starting to fill in with clouds. It was the smell of the air in March, that damp, wet smell. You know, the snow's just left, and the sun's leaving, and I know there's going to be a moon rising, and I just said, oh my God, this is the seeing of that Rembrandt painting. And when you pay attention, one of my great mentors, a teacher named George Nick, relayed a Cezanneism to me many, many years ago. And he said, you carry the idea around in your, Cezanne said, you carry the idea around in your head until you see it in nature. And this was one of those, like, aha, I'm seeing this, and I have to do something with it. So I pulled the van over, and I unload my painting gear. And I said, and I knew these guys a little bit from, morning coffee at the local market, but, we hadn't really, shared any words. And I just asked if I could sort of set up and paint, and they said, sure, and they cracked open a Bud Light and handed it to me, and then promptly forgot about me. Right, so I just disappeared into the landscape, which is the way I would have it. It's kind of like, photographers disappear too. There's something, once they figure out what you're doing, they don't ask any more questions, and they just let you, like good Vermonters, they just let you go on with your life. So that one session of painting, I made three little paintings that evening. In rapid succession. It was so exciting. And I came back into the studio with that palette all charged up. And I started this painting. And my wife Rachel said, and I called her in, I said, come look at it. And she said, well, are you going to do another one? I said, well, why would I? Why would I do another one? She said, well, how can you accomplish something in just one painting? Aren't painters supposed to work in series? And I said, oh, I think you're right. So I had never worked in a sustained series. I had made paintings that eventually formed a series, but to set out with the intention of, so I stretched 12 canvases, all the same size, and as is my habit, I work on one painting at a time. I don't have, a wall running of paintings, and I take the red and run down the wall. But so it's one painting at a time, one sort of focused experience after another. And it went on and on for about 3 years. And this is one of the last ones from that series, Orchardist. And it's like, and I respond to the Rembrandt painting, although it's changed. You know, it's not directly related to that little painting anymore, like as the first one was. And I'm also thinking about Goya, I think who learned a lot also from Rembrandt in those paintings that were in the Spanish Royal Collection. And you know, so I and as a printmaker, I know that that darkness squeezes light out. You know, the paper, you know, paint and paper are very different things. But the darkness has a responsibility and a kind of a, has a role in sort of squeezing the light out of something, pressing it forward. So that's kind of went into that. And I had, you know, so through all these years, right, I had refrained from looking at any pictures of forest fires. And I have a friend who travels around a lot, and he goes, he happened to be in Santa Barbara, and he was sending me photographs, and I said, no, I don't want to look at those. I want to look at George Catlin, because it seems to be more about, it seems to me, the photographs just don't seem plausible somehow, but this to me seems real. And, well, maybe not that deer in the front jumping over, kind of cute, but it's, but to me there's something really palpable about those paintings. But he embedded a photograph in one of his emails similar to this, and I happened on it. And I thought, oh my gosh. So I looked at it, and what struck me from his photograph was there was a swimming pool in the front. I just put this in for illustration. The swimming pool in his painting, in his photograph, was illuminated, and it was glowing turquoise. And then right over the, behind this, fancy modernist. I mean, the Hollywood, California life is so exotic, right? It exists only in television, in the movies, in my mind. But this, here's nature, here's this wildfire about to engulf this house. But I was looking at the swimming pool, and the pool was glowing turquoise. It was one of the most beautiful things I had ever seen. I could actually imagine standing next to it myself, painting it. And it seemed to me to summarize, it's the only painting I've ever made from a photograph, or well, not from the photograph, but sort of it's the photograph was the trampoline that sort of threw me into the painting. But it's this perfect bracket of sort of the wildness of nature, and then the beauty of something human made as well. And I learned subsequently that in California, during the wildfires, if you have a swimming pool, you're by law required to light it at night so that it can be used for, so the helicopters can find it to take buckets of water. I thought that was curious. So around the time of all of these fire paintings, a friend who's a curator, museum curator in Denver, invited me to go out for a hike, and I said, well, great, I'll just carry, you know, I'll bring my small oil painting set, and I'll bring my small easel. And he said, no, he said, you don't understand. He said, we're going for 4 days into a wilderness, a restricted wilderness area, and he said, you will spend all of your time surviving. You won't have any time to paint. And I did find a moment to paint, but I had 40 minutes, because if I sat any longer, the lactic acid would build up in my legs, and I would be basically immovable. And we still had another pass of 2,500 feet to get to. Now, I had talked to him a little bit about this, you know, letting go of the sort of burden of reality, and he said, have you ever gone out to just look at something? And I realized that I really hadn't, you know, that I had spent 20 years sitting in front of a canvas looking at something, but I had never really, I mean, sure, right, but never really walked intentionally to not paint. You know, I hiked and run and walked for exercise, right, but, you know, I'm thinking about something else. So it was an entire, I mean, it's as simple as, you know, going out your back door. But I hadn't really done it. I was moored to these canvases. And a whole new world opened up. And here I am. I'm sitting here at the Holy Cross Wilderness in Colorado at about 12,000 feet, soon to go up to about 13.8. That's the next pass. And this is the remnant of one of the largest fires in this part of the Rockies in the 1970s, and it's just now kind of starting to fill in again. So I was struck certainly by the scale and scope of this fire, but also about how long it takes for sort of the natural world to rejuvenate. And a number. As I was sitting there and as I was hiking through these, I was just making little drawings in watercolors in a sketchbook. But I started imagining that event. So instead of inventing my own events, I started imagining the course of other events. And I realized that much like those farmers that I encountered originally, I was I was painting these fire images in order to kind of burn down whatever I had already constructed. I was essentially burning the field, my own field over, in hopes of encouraging regrowth. I didn't fully understand that as I was getting into it. The contained forest fire gradually got out of hand a little bit in the paintings. And it started, for me, became an equation of the imagination, right? But it became this act very, very much like, what the farmers do. And then, of course, retreating to paint the ice is always, it's always a welcomed retreat and again, a further contrast requiring a very different kind of focus, but I love the unreality of the ice, right? Like I was asking my daughter, we were skiing this winter, and I planted my ski pole into the snowbank, and it glowed this most radiant turquoise I had ever seen, and it was a gray day. I don't know how that happened. I don't know the physics of how it is that this little pocket of snow could be glowing turquoise like that. And I asked her if she could see and if she could smell and hear the turquoise, right? Because I was just playing around with the idea of what's the response to this going to be? Because that's kind of how I think about it. And she just looked at me and she's like, yeah, whatever, She's 10, right? But Frederick Church built his career on these unrealities of reality. I mean, I don't have the slide here, but he went on numerous expeditions on ice cutters off the coast of Greenland, and he painted amazing little paintings in the palm of his hand, little panels about that big. And then he would come back to his studio, and he would make these gargantuan, fictional ice flows. And of course, he was presenting them. People paid handsomely to come see this in a theater like this, and they sat, and the velvet drapes were pulled aside, and everyone would ooh and ah. You can read the accounts; they're hilarious. But there's nothing accurate about these, except for a few of the turquoises that he kind of like. It's like he carried them in his suitcase or something. But the shapes and the sky, nothing else adds up. Of course. No one knew what they were looking at, and it was so that the imagination adhered to this reality, that's at the Dallas Art Museum. How are we doing for time? I just wanted to check with that because 6:50. I'm like only halfway through. But anyhow, I want to. I just realized that. But I want to have time for questions too. And I don't want to burden your evening terribly. I'll try to be brief and succinct. So, this in that retreat to the ice that I make after. After the fire paintings and certainly after the summer and whatnot, I realized that, this painting results from something that is very close to my heart, and it's the only painting that I've made that doesn't start with a paintbrush, right? It's a bit of a concept, right? It starts with a 19th century ice saw, and it comes from my father's stories of harvesting ice in the Finnish community in Western Massachusetts during the Great Depression. And it's the simplest, most reductive painting that I've ever made, and I'm working on a series of them. I will paint 10 of them over a 10-year period. I'm making one of them a year, and I'm attributing, you see the dates in parentheses there apply to the dates of the Great Depression. But quite literally, it's the plunge hole, or the avanto, in front of the Finnish sauna. And so, you know, again, it's representative of tremendous extremes. The inside of the building is 200 degrees Fahrenheit, and the water in that hole is about 34 degrees. And, you know, the human body actually wants to do that, or at least the Finnish body really wants to do that. But, you know, moreover, the painting is about other paintings, and it's a big black hole, right? But it's about, you know, again, it's like a way of like packing all of these paintings that I hold in high regard that are important to me somehow into an object that I've made. You know, it's a tremendous validation to feel like, well, and certainly some, you know, it takes it. I don't know. It's hard to do, and it amazes me when it works. But that painting is based on a number of things. In part, this burial at Ornan by Gustave Courbet, and of course this the Malevich, a Casimir Malevich black square, which I'll talk about again in a little bit. But it's also about you know, certain very American things, right? Like Andrew Wyeth. And by the way, Wallace Stevens says that sentimentality is a failure of the imagination. And really, upon reading that essay, I figured out what, I'm very interested in Andrew Wyeth, but it always falls flat for me because he kind of sabotages these very reductive, very beautifully seen things with an object of sentimentality. And many people respond to that. And in this case, I believe it would be that bucket, the bucket in the shadow there. But take a, you know, look at Andrew Wyeth's so-called realism and contrast it to this so-called minimalism by Ellsworth Kelly. I just see them as sort of opposite, absolute opposites. I see the Andrew Wyeth being sort of uncannily abstract, and I see the Ellsworth Kelly being very representational. I've followed his work for a long time, and I know that it's built on, everything is built on the observed, but it's so reduced, very exciting. And then this is a painter acquaintance of mine, who I think, does this better than anyone alive at the moment, and her name's Ellen Altfest, and she makes these small paintings that are painstakingly made. They're sort of, you can't call them hyper-real because there's so much observation of reality that it just kind of backfires, and they become these compressed, pressurized objects of paint. And you know, that's a similar goal that I have in mind for these ice cut paintings. You know, I want them, with minimal means. I want them to do a great deal. And so, you know, a little bit like discovering that that Rembrandt Rest on the Flight into Egypt painting. I encountered quite by accident in a very familiar book. From my printmaking days, I have this tome of Goya's drawings. It was produced in the 1970s, and it has absolutely every drawing he ever made. And I have combed through this book for 25 years, and I thought I saw absolutely everything. And then one morning of procrastination, I'm flipping through it again. And, you know, why am I looking at Goya? You know, I make these landscape paintings, right? But I look at Goya just to remind myself of the human element that I'm, the figurative element that I'm dealing with. And the book fell open to this image, and I was blown away. I couldn't believe it. I saw in it the inverse to my ice cut paintings, right? But I also saw the legacy of abstraction. You know, if you look at the Goya, it's an empty shape of white in the center of this drawing that's 7 by 12 inches. And you know, there's recognizable Goya, you know, the bats and these sort of murky figures, but nowhere else in his work does he employ a shape like this. In some paintings of the madhouse, he's got big areas of bright light, but this is a contained shape. And it kind of wants to be a door, it kind of wants to be a slab, and it kind of wants to be an opening, but it's really not, but it's both physical, it's both like an opening and a physical thing all at the same time. It's this sort of magic balance between the real and the unreal. And as I'm looking at it, I'm thinking about all of this, it's not the figures and the bats that are real anymore. They become unreal. It's that light that becomes the real, tangible object. And that's made in 1815. This is a bold assertion on my part, and I'm not an art historian, but there is no drawing or painting in existence prior to that that uses a shape of that proportion in that scale to that effect. It's essentially the beginning, I think, of geometric abstraction. And that's a tall order to fill, right? Because it takes 100 years, almost exactly 100 years, for the next sort of perfectly geometric painting to arrive. And the bizarre piece of it is that no one ever saw the Goya drawing. He made it, hung it on his wall, eventually put it in a stack of drawings that ended up in his grandson's collection, and it ended up in the Prado. It was exhibited once in the 1930s, and then again in the 70s, and then once in a show in the 80s. But Malevich never saw it, and Mondrian never saw it, and Braque and Picasso never saw it, as far as we know, right? But an idea was put out there, right? A painting was made, an object was made, and it existed, right? And then, I had been wondering, like, you know, if taking some, you know, Buddhist idea, you know, if a stone that is not dropped in a pond, can it still make ripples, right? I learned recently from a scientist that there's an explanation for this, and it's called, the term is called consilience. It's the idea that human thought exists and can be understood and received across time and across continents. And it's one of the examples that's readily at hand is the explanation as to how two polio vaccines could be developed, one in the United States and one, I think, in Germany, right around the same time. And there was no communication, no correspondence, no idea that these two projects were going on. But in this case, there's a lapse of 100 years. So that's something that's at sort of the forefront of one of my particular obsessions. And then the black, certainly the Malevich black square turns into this tipped white square. And then it comes full circle with the with James Turrell. Right, an artist I hold in high regard. I think he is, he's our living God, and he. I wonder if he knows about that Goya drawing, and So I've taken it to heart to explore it and study it. And I even looked at, you know, some of Goya's influences. And this is Watteau. Like Watteau painted clowns, right? Harlequins and actors, and he's very effete. You know, like really not much power behind a Watteau painting, because there's so much style to them. But this was a painting that was at the Prado, and I was looking at it in contrast to the Goyas, and I could start to see, you know, Goya was so receptive to everything that crossed his path. Of course, he lived in the shadow of Velázquez, and he lived in the shadow of Rembrandt, but he took all of those lessons and proddings. Well, you know, every time he walked past Las Meninas in the Royal Hall, it's as if Velázquez's eyes are following him and saying, you know, are you there yet? Have you figured out what I've done? Because Goya knew that he could get there, and he was receptive to it. But look what he gets from Watteau, you know, this open space on the left, and then that compression of light in that central figure. And it shows up in so many of his paintings, and this ochre, and also the way he utilized this, you know, the ochre background here. Here's a painting you can see upstairs. This is the piece that's on loan here to the Fleming. And I took those lessons from the Watteau, and I looked at those. And I looked at those trying to get at both Goya and what I was trying to do sort of outside of all of that. And, you know, it was, I mean, the marriage contract, right? I mean, this is... if you look off in the distance, there's the church. So the wedding, you know, the wedding actually happened in the church. But now, there's, for some reason, maybe is this the most important part of this particular union? It's happening in this beautiful woods, right? And the church is just, you know, just a reminder off in the distance. But I became really interested in that that human event in the landscape. And while I'm not quite ready to get, I'm not quite ready to include figures in the paintings once again, it's the occurrence of light, that momentary occurrence of light in the landscape that is, always on my mind. And that really is, the way that light exists is, I think, formed by, you know, a so-called pressure of reality. And I think on that, with that idea, I'll end here. And I hope you all can go up and see this painting. I don't know if there's time or the museum's open still,
I'm not sure. But
right. Anyhow, I'd like to thank you all for being here. Oh, I'm happy to take questions, sure. I broke my cardinal rule of more than 30, you're not supposed to show any more than 30 slides to any group, no matter how engaged they are in the subject. So anyhow, I broke that. Yes?
Thank you for sharing many insights and images that were very interesting.
Thank you.
I was hoping you might tell us a little more about Wallace Stevens and what he meant to you. He's one of my favorite poets, and I wondered if you might tell us more about what he means to you in your art or in your life.
Right. One must have a mind of winter, right? Wallace Stevens is, I don't know, he sits next to me at the kitchen table sometimes. And, you know, he's a good drinking companion now and then. And, he's someone that I'm not sure we would have gotten on splendidly, but I admire him greatly. He reminds me of the huge gaps in my own learning and intellect, and but he is, I think, interested in some of the very same things I am, which is in this, and he illustrates it certainly in these lectures, which you may have read, but. The bridge, sort of bizarrely intangible bridge between imagination and reality, and, you know, and what they are. And I think he spends his entire career as a poet discussing that and addressing that in his poems. But he addresses it in an airy sort of way, you know, like you know, the poem Portrait of Franz Hals, brushed up by brushy winds, you know, colder for blue, wetter for white. You know, he talks like a painter, and he instills images as if they were painted. And if you look through his poems, he knows what turquoise smells like, right? He writes about color. I mean, sort of the base. Maybe he's just a good New Englander, and we all have, you know, small talk built on the weather. But he makes it the sort of the entry point to much of his thinking about the human world. And of course, he is no realist. You know, he understands that what we see is not what we see, and it's really you know, you have to sort of go in through, you know, a double secret back entry, and in order to understand how things really appear. And I just go to him when I have, you know, some free time, if I have a question. So I don't have tremendous insights into it particularly. There are many more who do. But he says, I think if anything, to answer your question, I just feel a particular closeness.
It's remarkable that you still feel his presence so closely, and I'm sure he'd be very touched
right.
by that.
Apparently, he was kind of a grumpy individual, and you know, didn't have the happiest of lives. But thank you. Yes.
When you are painting your landscapes, your earlier work,
mm-hmm.
it certainly resonated so broadly with people, and they identified with you as this landscape painter, when you sort of decided to jump off that into something new that maybe people weren't expecting, how did you get the courage to like just make that leap? Because your galleries and your audience and people all waiting for the next, you know, view of the ballet. So how did you
right.
get, how did you do that?
So,
was it hard because people aren't maybe won't respond as well, or maybe they did?
Right. The question, in case you didn't hear, is, you know, how did I summon the courage to make the transition from painting things that people had become familiar with to something new? And to tell you the truth, I didn't really give it a moment's thought. But it also came at a particular time. You know, so in 2000, in September of 2008, the economy changed. I make my entire living from the sale of my paintings. I tell my kids, you know, everything we have here comes from my paintings. You know, it's, you know, I don't press it on them too heavily, but they completely understand. You know, it's really like making something from nothing, and that's, you know, that dried up. You know, I decided to take this momentary, hopefully, sort of lapse in the economy and in my personal economy, and I cashed in all of my whatever savings I had, my kids' meager college funds, and I put it towards making my paintings. And I used that time as, instead of feeling pressured by it, I felt complete, total relief. I could do whatever I wanted to do. But the work was already changing, and I really needed to summon the courage to follow that, and not worry, because I've been tremendously fortunate in my life and career that I've built an audience of people who follow not just the paintings but have followed what I do, and I had the good fortune of working with a dealer in Santa Fe, New Mexico, when I was 22 years old, who said, don't worry about your audience. Let the dealer worry about the audience. Just make your paintings, don't think about them. And that was some of the best advice. And you know, that's not entirely true, because I don't work in a vacuum. You know, I put my work out there to be seen. And I really welcome and enjoy people's responses. But it doesn't guide me one way or the other. It just, it's validating if nothing else, but partly it was just jumping in, you know. But if you've spent enough time in Finnish sauna, you know that it takes a certain amount of courage to go in that ice hole.
But after a while, you just learn to, you know, welcome the shock. So. Yes?
Well, I was thinking about Richard Diefenhorn.
Mm. Question is, how do I relate to Richard Diebenkorn's transitions and is place, and the role place plays in that. Diebenkorn is he's always been right there with me too somehow. But I think when I first started painting, I was very mindful not to make those sort of Richard Diebenkorn realist paintings, because every art school in the country has, you know, you have your Richard Diebenkorn, and you have your, all of the players show up among the students in these art schools, and I was interested in his lessons of observation. And when he made, so when I was making these transitions, some artists that I looked at were Diebenkorn and Philip Guston, just to name two, and I could see that they really were dealing with absolutely the same things from one way of working to another. It was just there was some deeper urge that needed to be satisfied. At least in the case of Richard Diebenkorn, Guston just said he wanted to tell stories and he was tired of painting pretty pictures. That was a little different motivation, but they were different. They were a different breed of curmudgeon, so I mean, I don't look at Diebenkorn so closely, and I'm not traveling as much anymore. To answer the second part of your question, I am really making paintings about. Well, they're not about sort of the topography of this place anymore, but they're more about this, some kind of mental visual topography. I mean, all of the places that I've traveled fuse together, and I can remember the lack of humidity on a Finnish summer day, or the humidity in the Cuban Cerva jungle, and it's those things, I can conjure those things up, and they help fuel the painting. As much as remembering things that I've looked at, and I go outside more intentionally now. As I said, I go out to look, and I go out into the fields and the hills behind the house in Saxon's River, I just took a group of about 12 kids on a beeline hike from the highway at exit 4 in Putney. Right up through the Houghton Brook Road to West Hill, and it's a beeline on the topographical map, and you cross the highway exit, and you see a world I learned so much. Of course, I was keeping up with 10-year-olds and all this, but I learned so much about the things that aren't seen. You drive past. Here I am finishing on this idea that I talked about in 1994. It's this idea that. How the highway carved, like a line itself, it was made so intentionally, and I think really beautifully done. It's like a parkway, still, the way it reveals Vermont, especially at this time of year. But to get off the highway by foot and go alongside of it and then across and then up to Route 5, Route 5 shares that north-south corridor. I mean, it was so exciting. So place is ever more important, but in a very different way. So I'm not making pictures of it any longer. So I hope that gets somewhere towards answering your question. Yes?
I'm curious about how your work as a teacher and your life as an artist, how that works.
Well, it works really well because I don't teach any longer. No. But when I was teaching, I do credit the Putney School. Like I said, I would never have hired myself, but if I had done anything else, I wonder if I would still be painting. I mean, I was in this fortunate position to be in a very beautiful place. I was paid hardly anything for several years, and I lived in a dormitory. And you know, I don't know if for anyone's familiar with independent school living, it takes everything from you. And of course, they have a willing 20-year-old; they'll take even more. But so I really had about an hour of time all to myself every day, and I learned because, and you know, I want at the end of the week, I'd like to see a few paintings. You know, I don't want to see one half-finished painting. I mean, it's just, there's nothing to look at, right? So I learned to paint these small paintings. I think some of the first paintings that Janie saw, little 11 by 14 inch paintings, I could set up and make, you know, one or two of those in an hour, looking very, not even thinking about them. In fact, I didn't even have time to think. And then I could pack up and head up to dinner and then on to my next activity. So by the end of the week, I could have a wall of, you know, 8 or 10 paintings. And then the weekend, you know, every other weekend was my own. So I learned how to use the time, and I still do that. Although, you know, I sometimes have stretches of 5 or 6 hours uninterrupted in the middle of the day. But, you know, everything fills in. And for all of you that are painters, you'll know that the outside world is not very kind to painters. The outside world does everything it can to keep you from painting, so you have to fight it. But I've learned how to work really quickly and not think about things too much. That was the hook. So anyhow, thank you for coming and